Let's use fastHTML to do an HTML-only multi-page application in Python. I already have an MPA done in Django. Let's just replicate that one using fastHTML and look at the differences. How much code do we need to write for this one? The same old high-level question still stands. Is it worth the effort of learning this new framework? So let's build this MPA in four steps. First, pages and routing. Second, content and forms. Three, email validation. And finally, database integration. Finally, let's compare the code and look at some surprising results. And then, what is the next step in evaluating the fastHTML framework? Now, what does this Django app do, I hear you ask? It is a simple app that collects emails in exchange for a PDF, or let's call it a lead magnet. It is implemented in Django and Python, and it's using the MongoDB in the back end. So it's a perfect example that we can make a copy of using fastHTML. Then what is needed to set up 5 new pages and do button routing between them? All pages of this application has got the same structure. It's using 3 cards. One on top, basically carrying the title of that page. Then there is a second card containing the contents. It could be text, images, or form. And on the bottom, there is a card containing buttons just for navigation in the application. Now to show a page, fastHTML sets up a route with this decorator at RT and a link. Since this is the slash root, it signifies the root entry of the application URL. This is followed by a function defining the HTML action. In this case, a get action. Def get. The get function defines the 3 cards that we're talking about as components, and then some text should be in there. We also have a button in the content card. This button should switch us over to the signup page when we press it. This combination of components, form and button, will be used all over this application. Then we can just repeat these basic steps for all the other pages. The signup page, the thank you page, and the 2 link failed pages that we will use later on in email verification. Now that we can run around these empty pages, we can celebrate 1 victory and move on to the next challenge. How about celebrating that with a subscription to this channel? In that case, you will learn a lot about fastHTML. The next challenge is content and forms. How is that done? The content in this case is just a copy of the text available in the Django application. So we just copy that text and dump it into the appropriate components on the cards. The form where we enter the email and our names is a bit more interesting. The form function takes a lot of parameters. The two first defines where the data of this form should be sent. So the routing and what action that should be used, in this case, a post. Then there is a second parenthesis, and that one contains a list of the inputs that makes up this form. First, we have an input of type email with name, ID, and placeholder. We also set a required setting on this one, because in this application, we really want the email. Second on the list, there is a text field where we can enter a name. Third, there is a field set which contains a label with some headings together with a checkbox that we can check. You know, the good old GDPR. And finally, we have the submit button. Now, there seems to be a requirement to define the type of the struct that a form reports back to its post function. Here we use the decorator at data class, followed by the class type definition, that in this case I call it signup with a big S. Then it is time to start the actual post function of the signups. Add rt signup and def post with the parameter data of type signup. In this case, just let us print this struct to the console and assume that everything is as it should be. And when we're done with that, we redirect the user to the thank you page. And for that, we're using the redirect response component with the address of thanks and the status code of 303. So, when we can fill in an email and a name and press submit, we can celebrate another victory and move on to the next challenge. When this app gets a new email, it must be verified. I choose to do this by creating a dynamic, personal, and time-limited page in this application and send the link to it to the email that has been entered. As long as it's not a fake email, the user of it could access the freebie, in this case, a PDF. The link in this case is a combination of the timestamp when it was created together with the email that has been entered. But you can use any kind of information in this link, I guess. Now I have this function implemented in the function processNewProspect, which I copied from the Django implementation, also in Python. However, I needed to adapt some imports since the implementation in Django uses Django imports. So I had to change them back to some standard Python library functions for email and time handling. When it comes to the email, I'm doing a multi-part email containing both a text version, an HTML version containing an image of a QR code. QR code that leads back to this personal time-limited link. As of now, I don't send those emails, I just print them out into the log to see that they work as they should. And they do. So, when we have a printed version of the email that looks okay, we can celebrate yet another victory and move on to the final challenge. Our final challenge here is an integration to MongoDB. fastHTML as a framework does an SQLite integration out of the box. Here, I will just ignore that one and do a Mongo integration out of the box using the PyMongo library. When do we need this database accesses? The write is needed when an email has been sent off to the user, because we want to store that link in long-term memory. We find this write in the signup form, the signup post function. DB, mlist, prosp, insert one, and end. Now, for the database entries, I have defined the database type entity, which is a slight increasement of the post data. We need some status and some timestamps to pull off this function later on. The read is needed when someone tries to access the application with their personal limited links. Is the link found in the database? If it is found and it's not yet expired, we update the database with the time of this PDF retrieval and mark the email as valid. This thing is done in the function of our last page, the dynamic page. It is at rt /mung/link in curly brackets, followed by define get with the link of type string. This is the actual link verification function. It checks the time now and does a search for the link in the database using find one. If it is not found, we raise an exception and redirects the user to the link not valid page. So if the link is found, we check if it has expired. If it is, we redirect to link expired page. If it is valid, we update the database with the time of collection and validation, and then responds back with the PDF file, the lead magnet itself. So, when we're able to catch bad links, expired links, and retrieve the PDFs, we are done with this implementation. But before we celebrate too hard, we can now really look into what we have got. Apart from just reading the code, how can we really compare these two implementations? We can look at it in the statistics side as well. If we look at the number of lines, Django needs 276 lines of code, while fastHTML needs only 185. That is, Django needs 50% more lines. If we do a word count, Django needs 1026 and Fast needs 917, so about a draw in words. I should say that this is a word processor counting words here. It's not really optimized for Python. But what about characters? The Django app uses 6,400, while Fast is using 5,300. It's about a 20% increase for Django. And finally, files. Django has got everything covered in 10 different files in a number of directories, while on the Fast side, there is one file with everything in it. Now, these numbers, they surprised me a bit. I was actually expecting Django to be more compact. I expected Django to provide more from the framework itself, but I seem to be misguided in this belief. So, less code for the fastHTML implementation. Yay! About the files. You can actually choose to split the fastHTML file into separate files. And you can do that because you want a better structure. But if you do that, you will need more imports and some other functions. This will lead to more rows and more characters. For an example, splitting the fastHTML application into ton files will decrease the line percentage from 50 to somewhere between 20% and 30%, and that is from imports alone. We need to keep this effect in mind when we look at code structure in a future video. All in all, round one goes to fastHTML. About the future. If you have seen this video about fastHTML overview, I'm now going through all those questions that came up during that discussion. What is next, you ask? I want to do a performance comparison between the Django application and the Fast application. And after that, an HTMX single page application adaptation of this application. And then, styling, code structure, and do make a comment below what you're missing and what you want to see more of. So to not miss out on any fastHTML content, do subscribe. When the next fastHTML evaluation is done, it will show up here. See you in there.